the Shanti Mantra, peace chant for today is on page 66 of the book Universal Prayers. Universal Prayers, page 66. The English translation is on page 67. Om Madhuvata Ritayate Madhuksharanti Sindhavah Madhvir Nasantoshadhihi Madhunatta Mutoshasi Madhumatpar Kivagam Rajah Madhudyaurastunah Pita Madhuman Novanaspatihi Madhumanastu Suryah Madhvir Gavo Bhavantunah Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om. May the winds bring us happiness. May the rivers bring us happiness. May the plants bring us peace and joy. May night and day bring us happiness and peace. May the dust of the earth bring us peace. May the heavens give us happiness. May the trees give us happiness. May the sun pour down happiness upon us all. May the cows yield happiness to us. Om peace. May there be peace in our hearts. May there be peace and harmony amongst all beings. And may there be peace everywhere in nature. Last time, we were studying the two verses, 47 and 48, in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. These are very important verses. And verse number 49 also. 49, 50. These four verses we will study. I'll chant the verses. Second chapter, verse number 48, 49, and 47, 48, 49, and 50. Om Karmanyevadikaraste Mapaleshu Kadachana Ma Karma Phalahe Turbhu Ma Te Sangosta Karmani Yogasthah Kuru Karmani Sangam Tyaktva Dhananjaya Siddhya Siddhya Samo Bhutva Samatvam Yoga Uchyate Durena Yavaram Karma Buddhi Yoga Dhananjaya Buddhau Sharanaman Vichha Kripana Phalahetavaha Buddhi yukto jahatiha ube sukrite duskrite tasmad yogaya yujyasva yoga karmasu kaushalam. These four verses, 47 to 50, they contain the most important points of karma yoga. The topic of Karma Yoga will come for discussion in many other chapters, beginning with chapter 3 and all the way until 18th chapter. Every place you find discussion of Karma Yoga. But these four verses in the second chapter, they contain the most important points of Karma Yoga. Here in the 47th verse, Sri Krishna says, there are four things he says, four points are made in the 47th verse. First point is, Sri Krishna is saying to Arjuna that we have some degree of freedom and ability to change things in regard to the work that we do, but not complete, total freedom. There also, limited freedom we have. Karmani evate adhikaraha. You can make some changes in the work we do. First point. Second point is, phaleshu mate adhikaraha. In regard to the fruits of our action, when we do something, whether we succeed or fail, in deciding success and failure, we do not have any freedom at all. That is the second point that is a little bit disconcerting, because we all have the feeling that we are the doers. I am doing all this work. I work so hard. I put everything into it. And yet, why should I not succeed always? But our experience shows that we do not always succeed in spite of our best efforts. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. This is true in all matters, in every field of human endeavor. This unpredictability of the outcome persists. We can't predict, we can't control the outcome of our work, no matter how hard we try. Why is this so? That answer is not given right here, but it is given later in the Gita. We'll come to that. Why it is that though we work very hard, sometimes we do not succeed? Once in a while, it so happens that our result exceeds our expectations. That is also possible. Why this unpredictability of the outcome? Why can't we control the outcome of our work always? Second point. The third point that Sri Krishna makes in this verse number 47 is Ma karma phala heturbhu. That means, do not assume that you are the producer of the fruits of your action. One meaning. Second meaning is, do not make the result as the motivation for your actions. You have to perform our actions, our duty, but what is the outcome that is going to happen, that's going to come, that is not in our hands, yet we have to perform our duties diligently and with love and with devotion. Ma karma phale hetur bhuhu. Do not be impelled by the fruits of your action. You do the work, and whatever result comes, accept it calmly without being perturbed if it is not to your liking. Third point. Fourth point that Sri Krishna makes in this verse 47 is Mate sangostu akarmani. Akarmani te sangha maastu. Akarma means not performing action. We may think that since I cannot control the result of my action, why should I bother to work hard? If possible, I will not work at all because I can't control the outcome. I cannot make what I want to happen. That line of argument should not be taken. May you not take recourse to inaction. May you not say that because I cannot control the outcome of my work, why should I bother to work? Or if I have to work, I will do something minimum required and get it out of the way. Why should I not take that position? That we have to understand. Sri Krishna says, may you not take recourse to inaction. You have to do your action as well as you can. At the same time, you cannot predict or control the result of your action. This is what he is saying. Now, all this seems difficult to accept because we have this strong notion that we are the doers of action. We have the notion that we are in control of everything, and we have the notion that we can decide the outcome of our work. That's not the case. Why it is not the case? That we'll try to understand that in our study of Karma Yoga. The answer will come a little bit later. And in the meantime, here the instruction is, perform all your actions diligently with love, as if you are doing worship and offering it to the divine, and then accept the outcome of the work calmly, even if it is not to your liking. That is the instruction. This instruction is explained more in the 48th verse. 48th verse is a very important verse. It has instructions for all the work that we do in all our lifetime. Whatever work that we do, this instruction given in verse number 48 is to be followed. Here Sri Krishna says, Yogastha kuru karmani, perform all actions as a yogi. Yogastha, being established in the attitude of yoga, perform all your actions. Now, what does yogastha mean? What does it mean to say as a yogi, with the attitude of a yogi? Two things are to be understood. Both are given here. Two points are made in this verse, 48. First point is very important. Sangam tyaktva. Sangha means attachment. We get attached to everything in our life. We get attached to the place where we live. We become attached to the people with whom we live and work. We become attached to the things that we use. We become attached to the instruments, the tools that we use. We become attached to the way of work that we are used to. We like to work in a certain way. We become attached to that, our method of working. We become attached to everything. The world is a very sticky place. Whatever we see, we become attached to it. So we should not become attached to our work or the fruits of our work. Sangam tyaktva means without attachment to the work that we do, because it may change the next day. If I am doing something today, there is no guarantee that I will be doing the same thing tomorrow. Something else may come, I may not like that work. I should not become attached to the work. I should not become attached to the fruits of my work. The fruits are not, the result of my work is not in my control. And I have, later I will be told to dedicate all the fruits of my action to the Lord. All action must be done as offering to the divine. That instruction comes several places later in the Gita. Whatever action I do is to be done as an offering to the Lord. Just as a servant does service his master with devotion, we have to serve the Lord by doing all our actions as his service. Or we have to perform all our actions as worship. That will come also later in the Gita. Everything is worship. Worship means something that is offered to the divine. Then I should not be attached to that one. So without attachment to fruits, to work and to the fruits of work, to result of work, we have performed action without attachment. Very difficult to follow. We will try to understand how to practice detachment gradually. First instruction, sangam tyaktva, giving up attachment. Second instruction is siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva. Siddhi means success in what we do. Asiddhi means opposite of success, failure in our work, in our endeavor. We have to remain calm, unperturbed, treating alike both success and failure because they are not in our hands. If I am responsible for success and failure, then I should be concerned about it. But earlier in the previous shloka, Sri Krishna says, result of your work is not in your control. Mahapaleshu te adhikaraha. You are not in charge of the outcome of your work. And it is something that is decided along by other factors over which I don't have very much control. We will study those factors later when they come. Siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva, remaining unperturbed, especially when failure happens. When success happens, is not a problem, you can manage. There also it is possible to become very proud and arrogant. If success happens, we should not allow that to happen. If failure happens, then we should not become depressed or angry or bitter or dejected. It happened because I did my best. Other factors over which I had no control played a part in shaping the outcome of the work. And I have done my part as well as I can. That's all I can do. The result is not in my hands. So, trying to remain as calm as possible in the face of failure. Siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva. This equanimity, samatvam, is the essence of yoga. The last part of the 48th verse, Sri Krishna says, samatvam yoga uchyate. Samatvam means remaining equanimous in success and failure. Siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva. This samatva, this equanimity, calmness of mind, accepting good and bad, all dualities calmly, without being perturbed, without became unhappy or angry. That is the essence of yoga. Remaining always calm under all circumstances. Sometimes people praise us, sometimes people blame us, sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail, sometimes good thing happens, sometimes bad thing happens. When all these changes happen in life, one should learn to remain calm and unperturbed after having done our part as well as we can. That is the essence of the instructions that Sri Krishna has given in these two verses, 47 and 48. Especially the first part. In regard to the work, only we have some control. In regard to anything, not only work, so many events happen in our life and we don't have any control over those events because other forces over which we have no control, they shape the events in our life. Our past actions is one of them. The result of past actions, prarabdha karma. Prarabdha means something that has begun to bear fruit, karma. That is affecting our present activity, our present work and the fruit of our work, and we have no control about what we did in the past. We cannot go back into the past and change what we did. If we did something wrong, we have to accept it as an inevitable factor in our life. Like this, other factors are there. These other factors which shape the outcome of our work, turn it in every some other unexpected direction, those are listed in the 18th chapter, in the 14th verse. When we come to that, we will study what are the other factors that affect the outcome of our work. To just give an idea about the other factors, for example, what other people do. In any work, other people are involved. Somebody else's work forms the input for your work, and what you do becomes the output for somebody else's work. You play a part in between, and your work is affected by what other people do in the same workplace. Maybe the other people who are participating in your project may not be even in the vicinity. They may be in some other country. You may not even know who they are. They will be working when you are resting, when it is night here, it is day in some other country where the other part of your work is being done. And you don't have control about the quality of the work that they produce, which forms a part of your work. So, for example, the work that other people do affects the quality of and outcome of your work. And you have no control about who the other people are. You can't have everybody who is working in your project. Somebody else does that. So we have no choice but to work with the limitations. There are always limitations in any work situation. There is no ideal work situation. Everything is not ideal in this world. Life is not ideal. There are always imperfections. So we have to learn to work within the framework of the imperfections, and we have to learn to remain calm if the outcome is not up to our expectations. Only if we have done our part very well. That's where we have control. Whatever is my part, that part I have to do very well. To the best of my ability, using the best judgment, and the best way I can, I have to do my part, and then I should leave it. Result is not in my control. So those are the, that is the reason why Sri Krishna says, samatva, remaining equanimous in success and failure. Success and failure are not in our hands. Work that we do, we have some control about how we do and what we do and when we do and what way we do. There we have to exercise our judgment, our control, and do the best that we can. So these are two important verses, 47, 48. It's not only in regard to work, in regard to any other situation also, we don't have any control in life. We think we can manage everything. We think we can control everything. But as we grow, advance in time, in age, we realize that we can't control anything. When we are young, we think we can change the whole world. I can control everything, I can do this, I can do that. But that experience shows us it is not so. In Sri Ramakrishna gives an example how limited our sphere of control is in any matter in our life. He gives an example of a cow being tied to a pole with a 10-foot long rope. The cow has a circle of 10-foot radius within which it can move about. It can eat all the grass available, it can sit down, it can jump about, it can move about in the 10-foot radius circle. But beyond that circle, it cannot go. In the same way, we have some freedom to do things in our life, but not total freedom. Within that limited sphere of freedom, we have to act wisely, using our best judgment. That is the nature of life. That is why Sri Krishna says, you have some control in regard to the work you do, but in regard to the outcome of the work, we have no control. So what is to be done? Samatvam yoga vachate. The essence of yoga is to remain equanimous in success and failure. In all situations, we have to try to remain calm and as unperturbed as possible. In praise and blame, in gain and loss, in pain and pleasure, we have to remain calm. Last time, I made reference to a stanza from Swami Vivekananda's Sangha of Sannyasin. Heed then no more, how body lives or goes, its task is done, let karma float it down, let one put garlands on, another kick this frame, say not, no praise or blame can be, where praise or praised and blame or blamed are one. Thus be thou calm, Sannyasin bold, say Om Tat Sat Om. In regard to praise and blame, gain and loss, pain and pleasure, these dualities are inevitable in everybody's life. No one is an exception. Therefore, we have to learn to remain calm under all circumstances. Samatvam yoga uchyate. That is verse number 48. Now, we go to verse 49. Verse number 49, chapter 2. Durena yavaram karma buddhi yoga dhananjaya buddhau sharanaman vichha kripana phalahetavaha. Work impelled by the desire for the fruit is indeed far inferior. Avaram means inferior. Varam means something that is preferred, highly preferred. Avaram means that is not preferable. Durena, by far, the work that is done expecting some benefit for oneself, selfish work, kamya karma, we can call. That kind of karma is karma, kamya karma, done with the expectation of benefit for oneself, is far inferior to buddhi yoga. Buddhi yoga means acting without attachment, without expectation of any particular benefit, without attachment to the fruits of work. That is buddhi yoga, as explained in the previous two verses. Explained in verse number 48, previous verse. Buddhi yoga means, here in this context, buddhi yoga means the attitude that I am not the doer, I only have limited freedom in regard to my work, and in regard to the fruits of my work, I have no freedom because other factors will shape the outcome of my work. Under these circumstances, I shall do my best and I shall accept the outcome calmly, even if it is not to my liking, even if it is not something that I expected. This attitude of samatva, equanimity in success and failure, is called buddhi yoga. So, work done with this attitude is far superior to the work done with selfish attitude, expecting a certain benefit for oneself. Buddhau saranamanvicha, take recourse to buddhi. Buddhi here means equanimity of the mind. Detachment and equanimity, two things. Buddhi in this context means, buddhi means intellect, thinking power, discriminating power, something that with which we can decide whether something is right or wrong, good or bad. That power of discrimination is called buddhi or intellect. Here it means two things. Whenever I do some work, I should do it without attachment to the fruits of work or to work itself or the fruits of work. Second thing is, since I cannot control the outcome of the work, I will accept the outcome of the work equanimously, with equanimity. I will not be too much elated and proud if it is successful, if my work is successful, and I will not be dejected and depressed if it is not successful. I do my best and leave the rest. Sometime ago I gave a Sunday talk. The title of the talk was, Do the Best and Leave the Rest. That's all we can do. That is a sense of Buddhi Yoga. Buddhav Sharanam Anvecha Kripna Phalahetavaha, verse number 49. Phalahetavaha means those who are impelled by the fruits of action. When they do something, they will always ask the question, what is in it for me? If there is nothing in it for me, why should I do? This attitude is not a healthy attitude towards work. Phalahetavaha means those people who do only work if there is something that they can gain from that work. Such people who are motivated by merely the fruits of work, they are kripanaha. Kripanaha means, the translation for the word kripana here means pitiful. Here it says, Dina Palahetava, wretched people, people who don't have a very sound way of thinking, they are kripanaha. The word kripana comes in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. In the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, which is the biggest Upanishad, there is a segment where there is a conversation between the sage, great sage Yajnavalkya, and the sage Gargi. There is, those days, women also were Brahmavadinis. That means they were Brahmajnanis. Women also were. Even now there are. So in this conversation between Yajnavalkya and Gargi, Yajnavalkya says to Gargi this sentence, defining who is a kripana. The definition of kripana is, Yajnavalkya says, Yova etadaksharam Gargi aviditva asmalokat praiti sakripanaha. O Gargi, that person who leaves this world, that means who dies, before knowing the imperishable Brahman, before attaining knowledge of Brahman, that person is a kripana. Kripana means anybody who has not realized God, who has not realized Brahman. Such a person is a kripana. But in the present context, kripana here means, kripana palahetava means, a person who is extremely selfish and who is motivated to do something only because there is something, some benefit coming from that work. Such a person with limited attitude, unhealthy attitude towards work and its result, who is a very selfish person, limited person, such a person is called a kripana. Kripana phalahetavaha. That means being motivated only by the result of work. I'll do something only if it benefits me in some way, if it brings some benefit to me. Otherwise, why should I bother? That attitude is not good attitude for seekers of devotion and spiritual knowledge, illumination. Buddhav Sharanam Anvecha. Take recourse to Buddhi. Buddhi here means two things, giving up attachment to work and its results, and remaining equanimous, samatva, in success and failure. So verse number 49. Verse number 50 contains a very important statement, a very nice, succinct definition of yoga. Earlier we saw samatvam yoga vachyate in verse number 48. Yoga means, in the context of especially karma yoga, in all other circumstances also in life, yoga means equanimity, remaining calm, unperturbed, under all circumstances. That's a very good ability. It's a very good quality to cultivate. We all have to cultivate that one. If you are upset by every small thing, then there is no peace at all. Let things happen, good or bad, pain or pleasure, I'm going to remain calm and do my best. That ability has to be cultivated with effort. That is samatva. Samatvam yoga vachyate. That was verse number 48. In verse number 50, he gives a very important similar definition of yoga. Let us do verse number 50. Buddhi yukto jahatiha ube sukrta duskrite tasmad yogaya yujyasva yoga karmasu kaushalam. Here Bhagavan Sri Krishna says, buddhi yukto jahati ube sukrta duskrite, with the intelligence of evenness, samatva, equanimity, with that attitude of equanimity, one becomes free from both good and evil. Ube sukrata duskrate. Whether something good happens or bad happens, it is not we should not be perturbed by those things. We should remain calm under all circumstances. Tasmad yogaya yujyasva. Therefore, perform all your actions. Here, yujyasva means become ready, get ready for performing your actions. Strive to your best of your ability, yujyasva. Yogaya, for the sake of performing all actions as a yogi, karma yogi. What is karma yoga? Yoga karmasu kaushalam. That's the most important part of this verse. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Here the word kaushala means ordinary meaning of the word kaushala is proficiency. If somebody is proficient in doing a certain type of work, then we call it kaushalya, kaushala, proficiency. Very well a person can do that one. In this present context, the word kaushalam, yoga karmasa kaushalam, kaushalam means proficiency in action is yoga. What is proficiency in action? That's we have to understand. This is a very important concept in verse number 50. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. The essence of yoga is proficiency in action. Now, the proficiency in action has three different aspects, three different dimensions, which we have to clearly understand. What is proficiency in action? What is yoga? First is the physical, merely practical efficiency, without doing some work, without wasting material, without wasting energy, without wasting time, in the most efficient way performing work, daksha, dakshata, the efficiency in work, efficient performance of work. Haphazardly doing something perfunctorily, not putting our whole heart and mind to the work that we do, that should not be done. That is one aspect of proficiency. Kaushala means efficiency in action. The second part of the definition of efficiency is how our work affects the other people and the situation, the environment in which we function. If I do something, is it going to be beneficial to the people near me or even those who are not near me? Is it going to be harmful to them? It may benefit me, but will it cause any problem to other people, animals and plants and nature? It may bring me benefit and happiness and profit, but if it is at the expense of the comfort of other beings, including nature, animals and plants and trees, then I should question the usefulness of the work. So how my work affects the outside world, other people, animals and plants, there I should not cause any loss or pain or discomfort to any other being, though that work may bring some benefit to me. So making sure that my work does not adversely affect the other beings, does not produce any adverse effect on the environment. That is second part of kaushalam. How does it change the environment in which I function? The third most important part of kaushalam is how does it change me, the performer of the work? If I do something, if it makes me a better person, if my work makes me a more unselfish person, if it makes me a more generous person, if it brings me peace and calmness of mind, if it enhances my devotion to God, then it is good work. Then I am doing it in the most proficient way. That work is meaningful. If the work I do makes me more selfish, makes me more narrow-minded, then it is not good. So third aspect of kaushalam is, how does it change me, the performer of the work? Does it make me a better person? Does it enlarge my thinking? Does it make me more narrow-minded or broad-minded? How does it change the person who does the work? Oh, I do. Sometimes people do think that will make them worse beings, that will make them meaner people. Bad things they do which will affect their personality, they will become lesser. They will not go in the right direction. Their life will go downwards. So that kind of work should not be done. That kind of activity or that mode of performing action in that way is not kaushalam. That is not. So the third aspect is, how does it change the person who does the work? So three aspects of kaushalam. One is the ordinary meaning of proficiency, doing the work in the most efficient way without wasting time, energy, resources and material. One thing, in the most efficient way. Second meaning of kaushalam means, how does my work affect the environment, other people, animals, plants, things and nature? How does my work have a beneficial effect on those people, or does it take away something from them? Does it cause them inconvenience or pain? Then I should question the need for my work. Third aspect of kaushalam means, how does it affect me, the worker, the person who does the work? Does it make me a better person? Then I should do that work. If it takes away from my personality, if it makes me more selfish, then that work should be questioned. Should I do? I should not do such a work. So the effect of my work on me, my inner personality, that is one part, most important part of kaushalam. So when Sri Krishna says in verse number 50, yoga karmasa kaushalam, these three aspects are implied in that word kaushalam. Kaushalam means proficiency. That is the essence of yoga. The whole gist of karma yoga is, when we do some work, these three things we have to make sure will happen. First thing is, how to do it in the best possible way, without wasting time, without wasting material, energy and other resources. Nicely, proficiently, efficiently I have to do whatever work I do. One aspect of yoga, karma yoga. Second aspect of karma yoga is, whenever I do some work, it should have a beneficial effect on the environment, on the other people involved in the environment, in the workplace or elsewhere, on the other beings involved in the work I should I do should not adversely affect any other being, including non-human beings. Second aspect of kaushalam. Third aspect of kaushalam is, the work must ennoble the person who does the work. It should make me a better person. The work I do should make me less selfish, more broad-minded, enhance my devotion, make me a better person, broaden my thinking. Instead of thinking what is in it for me, I should always ask myself this question. What is the benefit of this work, not only to me, but to all other beings in the environment? If I am an extremely selfish person, I only think about myself. I am hungry, I will eat. I don't care whether other people in the family, in the workplace are hungry or not. That is not efficiency in work. That's not kaushalam. Being concerned about the effect of my work on other beings in the immediate vicinity and elsewhere, in the faraway places also. Not only now, but sometime in the future also. Something may bring benefit to me now, but if it causes inconvenience to other people later in time, or to me later in time, that work I should not do. So kaushalam means all these aspects. The work I do should have a beneficial effect on me, the performer, and the other people in the environment, and should be done in the best possible way. This is the essence of karma yoga. One thing that we have to note in this context is, whenever we do some work, we should do it in the largest possible context. Largest possible frame of reference. Not just for me. If I do some work, if it only benefits me, brings me happiness, gives me pleasure, and if it does not do anything for other people, then why should I do that work? Then I'll be a very extremely selfish person. I don't want to be a selfish person. I want to be as broad-minded as possible. every person should ideally perform all actions in the keeping in mind the largest possible frame of reference. How does it affect me? How does it affect the other people in the family? How does my work affect the other people in the workplace, in the community, in the society, in the country, in the whole world, not only people? How does my work affect animals and plants and nature? That kind of larger, broadening our thinking, expanding the framework of our thinking when we do perform any action, that is the essence of karma yoga. That is what is called kaushalam yoga. Karmasya kaushalam means performing all our actions in the largest possible framework. Not just in the personal framework, not just how it affects me, benefits me, but how it affects, benefits other people, animals and plants and things. Does it have any adverse effect on other people, animals, plants and things in nature? These are the questions to be asked. A person who has this kind of consideration, performs all actions in the largest possible context, such a person is known as a karma yogi, yoga. That attitude is the essence of karma yoga, yoga karmasu kaushalam. So those are all things are implied in the word kaushalam, used in the verse number 50 in chapter 2, yoga karmasu kaushalam. Now we move on. Probably the most important part of whole Bhagavad Gita, according to some people. That segment was studied in a series of Sunday talks under the title Knowledge and Ignorance some time ago. We'll review that one now. That segment begins with verse number 54, with a question from Arjuna in verse number 54 and goes until the end of this second chapter. That segment of second chapter from verse 54 until 72, end of the chapter, is a very important, very interesting, very important, very practical part of the Bhagavad Gita. We should study it in great detail and also practice these ideals given there in that segment. This segment is called Sita Prajnasa Lakshana, the traits, qualities of a Sita Prajna. So Arjuna begins this, asks this question in verse number 54, Arjuna's question. Arjuna Uvacha Sita Prajnasya Ka Bhasha Samadhisthasya Keshava Sita Di Kim Prabhasheta Kimasita Vrajeta Kim. Arjuna asked the question, O Krishna, how can a man of stable wisdom, steady wisdom, anchored in concentration, be described, O Krishna? How to describe the qualities of a sage of steady wisdom? How does such a person speak? How does such a person behave? Even small actions like sitting down in a place, on standing up from a sitting position, or walking, or eating, or drinking water. Small actions like this, we can see a difference. When a careless person does these things, he does it in a careless way, in an uncouth way. Sitting down in a very, in a wrong place, in an uncouth manner, is not to be done. When a yogi does the same simple actions, there is a beauty in the yogi's actions. There is harmony in the actions, simplest actions of it. They don't have to be very big, important projects. In very simple things such as how to sit down, how to speak, how to handle things, how to keep a book on the table. These are very simple things. In these simple things, how a person behaves, that defines the person. Everybody cannot do very great deeds, but everybody is doing all these small things in their daily life. Our daily life consists of doing small things. No big things happen in our daily lives, really. But it is, what is important is how we do even the little things that we do. Swami Vivekananda explains the importance of doing little things properly in the Karma Yoga lectures. He says, if a person's character is defined by how he does small, daily little things. If a person may be occupying a high position, he may be a professor in a university or a great scholar, but if he does not perform his action properly, he is no better than a janitor, for example, who does his work very properly, very nicely, with devotion, carefully, nicely. So it's not what we do that matters, it is how we do what we do that really matters. So what is the way, how does a person of steady wisdom, Sitta Prajna, behave? How does he do small things? How does he sit? How does he talk? How does he walk? How does he do small things? Sitsadi kim prabhasheta. How is he spoken about? How does he speak? Kim asita vrajet kim. How does he come? How does he go? How does he behave? Explain this to me. In other words, the qualities of a sage of steady wisdom who has achieved the highest knowledge. The reason why Arjuna asked this question is twofold. There are two things that we have to notice about this this question, very important question Arjuna asked. First is, there is a descriptive aspect. Sri Krishna is going to describe the qualities of a Chitta Prajna, a sage of steady wisdom, so that we can recognize and emulate such a person. Second thing is, there is a prescriptive part. There is a description, there is a prescription. Prescription means it is an instruction to all of us, prescription to all of us to do, to practice these virtues, so that we can also become a Chitta Prajna. It's not enough for us to know somebody else is Chitta Prajna, somebody else has this quality, so he is Chitta Prajna. This is one part of it. Description helps us to recognize such a person. Now, we should not stop there. There is a prescription also. Krishna is prescribing, you do these things also, so that we, each one of us, has to and can become a Chitta Prajna. Becoming a Chitta Prajna is human destiny. Nobody can avoid it. We can postpone it, but we cannot avoid it. We all have to become Chitta Prajna because that is our intrinsic nature. We are Chitta Prajna by nature. This limitation that we are experiencing is not our true nature. It's only an aberration. This is not what we are, what we think we are now, a human being. I'm a doctor, engineer, I'm a son, I'm an old man, I'm a sick man, I'm a rich man. This is not what we truly are. This is not intrinsic. This is not what we truly are. Our true nature is Satchidananda. We are that. The Chitta Prajna nature is in us intrinsically. Now it is there. We have to manifest it. We have to experience it. We have to know that one. Experience it. That's our destiny. And we'll do that. So how can we do that one? What specifically we should do and try not to do, avoid certain things, to become a Chitta Prajna, to manifest our perfect Satchidananda nature. So that is why there is a prescription part in this list of qualities that Sri Krishna is going to give from the verse number 55 onwards. We will study that, the remaining portions, verses of the second chapter, with great care, as much detail as possible, so that keeping in mind that these are things we have to practice. Each one of us has to practice these virtues as much as possible, so that each one of us can experience our true nature, manifest our true divinity inherent within us all. Swami Vivekananda said, each soul is potentially divine. The divinity is within us in a potential form right now, with every one of us. Whether we know it or not, whether we believe it in it or not, whether we accept it or not, we are divine. That's a given fact. Vedanta says that, Tattvamasi, you are that. You are that Satchidananda now. But we have to experience it and know it by our own experience. Not enough, now should not be satisfied by reading about it or listening about it, by knowing somebody else is the prajna. But what about me? Each one of us has to manifest the divinity, to certainly be present within us in potential form. That is why this list of qualities of a Chitta Prajna that Sri Krishna is going to give in the remaining verses of the second chapter, this list is very important list, and we'll pay attention to all those verses from next time onwards. Now, to begin that segment, I'll chant verse number 55. Sri Bhagavan Vacha Prajahati Yada Kaman Sarvan Parthamanogatan Atmanye Vatmana Tushtah Stita Prajnastadochyate. In this verse, very important verse, 55, Sri Krishna gives two things, two qualities of a Stita Prajna. We'll try to understand these two qualities. Prajahati yada kaman sarvan parthamanogatan. Kaman prajahati. When a person, yada means when a person can conquer all the desires, sarvan kaman, where do the desires arise? Manogatan. The desire in they arise in the mind. The mind is a fertile ground where all the desires are lurking underneath, and they come to surface when an opportunity is available. So all the desires are already there within us in seed form. They come and manifest, they come to the surface and express themselves as desire. We'll try to understand this in a little bit more detail in the next class. We'll just begin the study this time. Yada sarvan manogatan kaman prajahati. When a person is able to conquer and control and deal in a healthy manner with all the desires that arise in the mind, tada, such a person is called a sthita prajna. One point, how to deal with the desires that arise in our mind, in our minds. Numerous desires come into our minds. Sometimes these desires are so strange and unfamiliar. You really want to do this one. We think like that one. So when a desire comes to the surface of the mind, we have to do two things. First thing we should not do is to impulsively jump into fulfilling that desire without thinking about it. We have to ask our questions, what kind of desire is this? If I fulfill this desire, how much happiness will it bring? If I fulfill the desire, what is the cost, what is the price I have to pay? At what cost this happiness will come? Is it good for me in the long run? It may be giving pleasure in the short run, but in the long run, if it is not good for me, should I still go ahead and fulfill the desire? And what is the effect of my fulfilling the desire on other beings in the surroundings, in the vicinity? How does it affect other people? If I fulfill this desire, it may make me happy for the time being, but if it causes inconvenience to other beings, animals and plants included, environment included, is it worthwhile fulfilling the desire? Is it a good desire, a bad desire? What kind of desire is this? All these things we have to think before proceeding to fulfill the desire. So the whole psychology of desire and the consequences is described in a later verse, in verse number 62, two verses 62, 63. We'll come to that and study the topic of desire in great detail when we come to that topic. Here, briefly, when a desire arises in a person's mind, if he can somehow think about the desire, its consequences, and if he can control the desire, such a person is a sthita prajna. A person who impulsively jumps to fulfill any and every desire that comes to a person's mind without thinking about the consequences, then such a person is not a wise person. So one quality of sthita prajna is, when a desire comes to the mind, a person must be able to think about it calmly, evaluate the desire and its consequences, and proceed further proceeding to fulfill the desire. One thing. Second thing is, Atmanye Vatmana Tushtaha. When a person is able to conquer all the desires, one. Second thing is, when a person is happy within oneself, atmani vatmana tushtaha. Such a person is independently happy, does not depend upon any external circumstances or resources for happiness. Generally, we look for happiness outside, in the outside things. A person looks for happiness in money, property, possessions. Some people look for happiness in becoming more famous, fame and name. Some people find happiness in other kinds of pleasures. Some people find happiness in wearing good dress and clothes and driving expensive car or eating tasty food. These are all various things which are all outside things in which people seek happiness. But where is true happiness? That's the very important question we all have to ask at some point. I want to be happy, and everybody wants to be happy. No one wants to remain unhappy. Where am I seeking happiness? Am I seeking happiness in the place where it can be found, where it is present? Or am I seeking happiness in the wrong place? Those questions are to be addressed. A sitapragna is one who knows where to find happiness. Happiness is not in the outside world. Happiness is not in money. Happiness is not in property. Happiness is not in power, position, in big houses, in expensive cars, in good food, in dress, in clothing, in beauty, in youth. These things do not give us any happiness. Though they may appear to give us happiness for some time. There is no true happiness in these things. We'll discuss these topics in greater detail in the next class. Now I shall say the closing prayer. Before I say the closing prayer, I want to say one thing. This is not an interactive class. You know, it's not same as everybody sitting together in one room and discussing things. This is a one way. I'm just speaking and you are just listening. So please, if you have questions, send me your questions by email or call me. And I will be happy to talk with you, and to the extent of my knowledge, as much as I know, I'll be happy to explain the answers. Don't hesitate to ask me questions either by email or by telephone. I will be very happy to do that for you. And now I shall say the closing prayer. Om Sarve Bhavanta Sukhinah, Sarve Santa Niramayah, Sarve Bhadravani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Tat Sat. Sarvam Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Om, may all be happy. May all be free from afflictions. May all realize what is noble and auspicious. May no one be subject to misery. Om Peace. Peace be within us all. Peace and harmony be amongst all beings. Peace be everywhere in nature. Harihi Om Tat Sat. Sarvam Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Stay well. Until next time. Thank you very much. Namaskar.